Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN Podcast. I am your host, Billy, as I keep forgetting to mention my own name. I am joined this week by the Prizefighter himself, Dean Ford. How you doing?
I'm all good, Billy. How are you doing?
I'm not too bad. Now, I will say now, we are recording this in November. So just in case you're looking at Dean there and thinking, that is a cracking Bronson-esque moustache, that's why it's there. It might still be there when February rolls around, when this goes out into the general public. But if you're watching this on the Patreon, which you should totally sign up to, it will totally make sense because it's for November. I usually go for the boring question first, but we've mentioned the moustache in the room. Who are you raising money for?
November charity for men's mental health.
Excellent. We'll just get right into the mental health bit because Stephen Louch, who you've spoke to before on Tuck of the Drop,
yeah.
he just wanted to put over your social media, wiping over sharing out mental health related stuff that you've always shared it, and he wanted to just give you a little bit of props for that.
Oh, I appreciate that. Thanks, Stephen.
So we'll probably get into a little bit more as we go along, but we can't stop without asking the first boring question, which is, how did you get into pro wrestling?
So mine's is pretty strange. So my first memory would have been it must have been between 97 and 98, because I think I was about 4 or 5 at the time, and I'd never ever seen wrestling at this point. And I was up at my cousin's house, and he's like maybe 10 years older than me, so he would have been about 14 or 15 at the time, and he put this wrestling on, and I didn't really know what it was. And there's this wee guy with a mask just jumping about, wee mini luchador. And it turns out, looking back, it was Masquerito Sagrada for AAA. So I don't know, I think the WWF were doing like a partnership at the time. I had no idea. This was like my first ever encounter with wrestling. So that was it. I never really bothered with it. And then I don't know how long later, maybe a few months or whatever, Saturday morning as a kid getting up early, mum and dad are still sleeping, just flicking through the channels. And I find SmackDown on Sky One. And it was, the Undertaker was cutting a promo during the Ministry of Darkness era, and it was like this big backdrop with lightning, and it was like a church and stuff. And obviously at the end of the promo, he does the eye roll, and I can just remember being totally drawn in as this wee 5-year-old kid. Like, I don't know what this is, but it's cool.
So that's a bit of a difference. You went from the weird 97 year where WWF were trying to make partnerships with everyone. The cool luchadors from AAA. That rumble that year is just a weird concoction of everything. Then coming to what 2000, it must be 99 then, around about then, Mystery Taker.
I'm not entirely sure exactly, but about 98, 99, I'm guessing, yeah.
Yeah, so the runoff from the new gen into the Attitude Era. So that was it from that point. Undertaker, eye roll, hooked.
Yeah, for then on in, that was me every morning. Just try to, obviously we never did internet that back then, so we're just doing as much as you could to find out more just by watching it. And I seen the games and stuff, and just constantly saying to my dad, where can we go? I want to buy figures, I want to find merchandise, get my dad to travel length and breadth of the country. And that was it for that day on, just obsessed.
Oh yeah, I mean, I was in the same boat then, because I started watching around about 98, 99 as well. So it was of course, 2000 was the Channel 4 time, which was the best time, because you got to see Heat on Sunday. And then if you were lucky, you got like Raw Rumble or Fully Loaded or something on Channel 4 as well. That was the best time. But yeah, I remember that as well. I wanted to buy figures. Do you remember what your first figure was?
My first figure was actually a WCW Macho Man.
Oh, it was
and it had like the sunglasses and the frilly boots and stuff.
I was at the like the NWO the macho and like white.
Like a wee belt and stuff.
Oh, cool. That's fine. Yeah, mine was draws, which is just random. It's just draws. So yeah.
At the time, I didn't even know who Macho Man was because I was only watching WWF at the time, and it must have been maybe a year later or whatever. Nitro was on Channel 5, and then I started watching that as well. Goldberg and Sting and all that. It's just a totally different thing for watching even WWF at the time.
Of course, yeah. Was it Worldwide that you watched on Channel 5? And had like, I remember anyway, if someone got hit with a chair, they would come up with the big Batman kablams and that over it.
I can't remember that far back exactly, but I can just remember, I think it was a Friday night, it was on Channel 5, and Goldberg, as soon as I seen Goldberg, I was like, this guy is cool.
Of course, wrestling wasn't your first sport then, doing it sport. Kickboxing was quite near a start. Was it, were you always quite an athletic background before you got into kickboxing, like football and stuff like that, or was it just straight into it?
So I played football as a kid, and I was always quite active. So like, going out playing and climbing trees, and always playing wrestling in the garden with my friends, and playing wrestling in the living room, and trampolines and whatever. And I was always, I think, for that age, as soon as I seen wrestling, that's all I thought about. But back then, there wasn't really anything that I knew of. And I started to get interested in, you know, like boxing and kind of martial arts and stuff. And I started training kickboxing at 11. And just kind of took it from there.
So it was like you're as close as you could get to wrestling, kind of start off point.
Well, obviously wrestling was my first thing, and then as I started getting older, my dad was quite a big boxing fan, so I would watch that, and then as the internet started to kind of get bigger and YouTube became a thing, you just end up in a rabbit hole looking at different things, and I liked it. Jean-Claude Van Damme movies and Bruce Lee movies and stuff like that. So it was just ended up being the route that I ended up going, sort of thing.
And I mean, not to put it lightly, but you've been pretty successful in the kickboxing world. One of the questions I got was, of course, there's all manner of belts that you've collected. Stevie ABZ, he did a video for yourself. I think it was part of Pro Wrestling Scotland or Pro Wrestling Innovation, one of the two. And he wanted to ask about the history of like the belts that you've won and what belts you've won in kickboxing. So if you wanted to speak a little bit, what have you won?
I've won 4 British titles and 9 Scottish titles.
As just a different weights or?
Yeah, so all the way I think I won my first at 13 up until adult level. Just obviously as you get older, you go through different weights and different age categories and stuff. So,
So did you find, like when you had to transition from, we're speaking about belts. What belts in the background of that picture that Alexander Darwin McCallum always uses?
So that's one of my British titles. Probably my favourite, to be honest. That's how I like to.
Well, I mean, you've got the thumbs up with it. It must be high up there.
That infamous picture.
The one I use for getting the pictures in as well, because it's just, I mean, I've started doing it now because it's just so, it makes me laugh so much.
I've ended up just doing it now just to pop myself. It's just gathered arms and legs. So I was like, why not? Just run with it. See what happens.
Why not? Yeah. So yeah, it's ADM's fault that I've started doing it, but yeah, it's just it doesn't matter as long as it's like I write, pal. You can just throw it anywhere. It's great. Yeah. It's a great picture. It's one of your British titles. Excellent. So did you find transitioning when you actually saw there was a school in Airdrie where you trained? Do you find the contact nature of it was a little bit easier to transition with because you did the kickboxing so much, or did you find it a little bit harder because you didn't have to actually kick people so hard?
It was easy in certain respects and really hard in others. So like, because I was pretty fit and athletic and stuff, like a lot of the basic movements, like the rolls and stuff, and like the actual fitness of it, I took to really well. But when it came to like the contact and stuff, it was like trying to retrain everything that I knew and like turn it upside down, if that makes sense. So for instance, like obviously if I'm fighting a full contact kickboxing fight, my aim is to hurt the guy as much as I can, and although I might be hurt, I need to pretend that I'm not. And obviously in wrestling it's almost the total opposite. So yeah, you're trying to make it look as if you're hurting people without hurting them, and make it look as if you're hurt when you're really not. So it's like, just it took a while, but I like to say I've got there in the end, hopefully.
And were you still doing kickboxing competitions at the same time, or are you still, obviously nothing's happening?
To start with, I was just kind of tailing away from it. That was part of the reason that I decided to start wrestling, is because I just kind of got to the stage with kickboxing that I wasn't really enjoying it the same. And because I had trained for so long and it just became part of my life, I couldn't go for like training almost every night to just do nothing. So I needed something else to fill that time, if you know what I mean, like another interest. And that's when I decided to do wrestling. But I was still training and stuff, but that kind of helped as well. Like even some of my kickboxing coaches and stuff, they would help me with stuff, like ideas, and but do you think this would work? So they were pretty good for that point of view.
So I mean, if you're tailing off, at least you didn't have that kind of awkwardness of one weekend you're pretending to be hurt and not hurting anyone else, and then next weekend you're trying to kick lumps out of someone. Trying not to get them mixed up, because I don't think anyone would appreciate it. I mean, the guys you're fighting in the kickboxing might appreciate it if you're not hurting them, but the people in the wrestling, maybe not so much if you're just putting them. So you started it, started in Airdrie. Of course, you must have got your start round about there as well. So what was it like going into your first match? I mean, kickboxing would have been more focused sport. You're aiming to win. You're not trying to please the crowd. So when you go into that first match and you have to get the crowd involved, assuming heel, just because usually kickboxer.
I was actually babyface my first match.
Can't imagine as a babyface.
Nah. It turned out that wasn't really the right for me, but I actually thought I would be fine going into my debut because I had performed in front of a crowd before, albeit obviously it's completely different, but I thought by having that kind of experience I'd be okay, but I was an absolute nervous wreck. Like, it was horrible. I think because it is so different, like as you said, when you're competing in a fight, you're not caring about the crowd, you're only caring about the guy that's in front of you, where wrestling's completely different, where it's probably more about the crowd than anything else. You know what I mean? That's the reason that you're there. So it was just a totally different experience. It was a bit of a shock to the system, to be honest, but it was good at the same time.
Well, wrestling, it's just a performance art, isn't it? I mean, yeah. I think you can see places like abroad and just anywhere doing all these flips and doodads and what have you, but really, all you need to do in wrestling is just get the crowd reaction, and then once you have the reaction, it's straightforward. In my opinion, from someone who's just sat in a crowd, not actually done it, but I think once you've got the crowd, you can do literally nothing, and you'll have you still have the best match on the card by doing nothing. So it must be just a real change. first match I saw you in live was in W3L. That's when you came to Elgin. And at that point, you weren't Dean Ford. You were simply Ford, which is number four, capital D.
Ford.
We'll get into that, I'm sure. But I remember it. You may not remember it because what happened, but you end up coming out of the ring and cracking your head off the just the wooden ground and splitting your head open. So this is maybe a year, if that, into your wrestling?
Not even, I think maybe 6-7 months.
So other than...
I debuted in the December, and I think this is maybe like the June or the July, something like that.
Must have been, because it's often around about my birthday, so it's July. It usually come up. So other than the floor, what was your first thought going through your mind when that happened?
So that wasn't actually about to split my head. A lot of people seem to think it was, but it wasn't. So what happened was, to go back, I was pretty nervous because I think it was one of the first companies I'd worked for out with, my kind of parent company. And obviously I was brand new, I was green as grass, I'd only been on shows a few months. So I'm thinking, right, all the way up to Elgin, hopefully put in a good performance and I'll get brought back. I think it was one of my first times working heel, and I've not even made it into the ring yet, and I've slipped on the apron and took a back bump on the floor before I've even got in the ring. So that was a great start. And I get in the ring and the referee said to me, well, at least it can't get any worse. Famous last words. So it was myself and Kev Williams in that match. And we got to about halfway through the match and he hit me with a bubble bomb. So on the way down, as I've landed my bum, whatever's happened, I've took like a whiplash effect and my head's went back into his face and we've collided.
Oh.
And I've turned around and seen him holding his face and I was, oh shit, I've hurt him. And what I didn't realise to the end of the match was that I was covered in blood. And obviously his teeth or his face had collided to the back of my head and split me on. I didn't even realise this at the time. I just kept wrestling. It wasn't after a match. I looked down and my full body was just covered in blood. And I was like, oh well.
It was certainly one way to leave an impression. I mean, Chris, you came back out afterwards
with the big
massive bandage and everything.
It wasn't as simple as just going home. I had then to wrestle again, so that was an experience.
Well, at least it showed, I mean, like you say, about six, 7 months into your actual in-ring career that you were just quite happy, but you were willing to just to keep going and come back out and do that, which, I mean, for me, I was the first time I was seeing you and otherwise seeing you kick folk on GIFs and what have you. So it left pressure on me. I mean, I wrote about it as just the Scottish wrestling guy, but I certainly enjoyed it. So it made me excited to see what else you could do, which I got to see again when SWA came up for Rock and Wrestle, however long, two, three years ago. I have no idea. Time has gone, just merged.
Yeah, this year just erased all time.
Oh, the last episode that I've recorded was with Omar Mohammed, and we're just sitting there just going, I don't know what date's watch, because coming out in 2021, but we're in 2020, and we're speaking about last year, but last year's 2020 in the recording, and then it's just, we're just like going, I don't know anymore, we're just going to guess at this point.
Just make it up as you go.
So what was behind the slight tweak in the name from Dean Ford to just Ford, like the 4D? Was there any thought, or did someone come up to you and go, that?
No, I don't know if it was when I had started training or before I started training. I can't really remember, but I had this great idea. Why don't I just do 4D? And I thought it was amazing. And everybody that I spoke to was like, that is absolutely horrible. Like, And I was like, no, it's cool, man. Like, 4D, 4. And it wasn't here, like, I don't know how many people had been like, listen, I'm just going to be honest with you. That is guff. Just use your own name. And I was like, all right, okay.
Like, so, I could see, honestly, I could see your thought behind it. Because if I saw it and it said 4D, I thought, I get it, Ford. Oh, that's cool.
Yeah, but then, if you don't know, then it just does a shambles.
Yeah.
In my head, I was like, that's dead catchy. That's cool.
That's a t-shirt.
Really back, I was like, that was absolutely awful.
Well, we've got to go through these things before we settle down. So Your character is obviously the extension of yourself, kickboxing, lots of strikes and punches. Was that just that was your comfort level? Were you just happy just to go with that? You weren't rushing to do any flips and
well, actually, to start with, I had these great ideas of being this big high flying sensation. That was my initial thoughts because at school and that, I'd done like gymnastics and trampolining and stuff, so I was quite able to do some stuff and that. And that was always the kind of wrestling that I liked growing up, like Rey Mysterio, Jeff Hardy, RVD sort of thing. But I don't know when it was I came to the realisation, but I was like, I've got these skills I've learned in the past 15 years, like fighting. I've fought all over the world, do you know what I mean? Is it, why waste what I already know, do you know what I mean? And I just thought it would be better to just, as you say, just be an extension of myself, using the skills that I already have.
Absolutely. I mean, it's not the easiest way, but it's like, it's the most comfortable way. I mean, there's no point in trying to change the wheel if you've already traveled on it, kind of thing. That's a terrible analogy, but that's the one I'm going with. So and also, to be honest, in Scotland, you don't get that many strikers at the moment. Well, they're coming through now, likes of Ian Skinner and Bradley Poole's more a grappler, but it's like you don't really get these hybrid wrestlers at the moment.
Was kind of my thinking at the time as well, because when I first started training, I was just starting to watch ICW and obviously, at the time, Alistair Black was Tommy End in ICW at the time, and he had this kind of similar style, but there wasn't really anybody else that was doing that at the time, so I thought it's kind of different, do you know what I mean? And it's something that I'm more comfortable with, so that's kind of why I went for it. And obviously, with my moveset and stuff, I take a lot of inspiration from Alistair Black, do you know what I mean? That was one of the guys I first kind of looked up to as well. So
so you've ended up travelling across the country into England as well for Shield Pro Wrestling. So it was just a case of picking up opportunities when you could, or was it just, were you on the camps as well? Am I thinking that right as well?
On the camps as well, yeah.
So how was the camps for you? Just because that's, again, from people that I've spoken to in the past, it's a different environment because it means you just do less and less and less for a bigger reaction, but multiple times a day. So how is that?
For me, that's the best experience, learning experience I've had to date, 100%. Like, people don't realise, like, I see online and stuff, like, the camps gets a lot of stick with, certain audiences and certain groups of wrestlers and stuff, which I just think is mind-boggling, because everybody I know that's worked for whatever company, All-Star, Mega Slam, WW, doing a full summer, it's like a full schedule. Like, it's as close to as a full schedule as you would get in this country. Like, I think it was a 9-week run we done, and it was 5 or 6 shows a week for 9 weeks. Like, at that point, I think I was only 2 years in, if that. So I was maybe wrestling once, twice a month. And when I got the opportunity, I just quit my job straight away. I was like, just spoke to my manager and I was like, listen, I've got an opportunity that I really can't pass by. It was a no-brainer. Like, I didn't even have to think about it. I couldn't pass that opportunity up, do you know what I mean? And since that, I've the level that I've came to for then is just night and day.
Absolutely. I mean, 9 weeks of 5 or 6 shows, so you're looking at, what, 54 matches at least during that run, unless you come back for a battle royal or something like that towards the end. And that gives you 54 opportunities to tweak a thing, add a move, try a move. And I don't often see, because my Twitter, when I see drama going on Twitter, I'm just like, I can't see it because I seem to be following all the good ones. But I don't know why people would look down on camps. I've seen shows that are just terrible, and I could see why people would look down them. But if you've got a camp experience with names that have been trained by recognisable talent and got a reputation for putting out good talent, then 54 opportunities to, that's 54 more matches than you would have got if you didn't do the camp. So it's just, I mind-boggling. I don't see why anyone would.
Like you were saying as well, like, you're learning how to work people. Like, been on a wrestling show, even a family-friendly show, is one thing, and keeping them entertained. But they're there to see wrestling. So they're going to watch it regardless, unless it's absolutely awful. But the holiday parts is different because you're going to a different crowd every day. And the majority of them aren't even interested. They're only there because it's part of their holiday package. So your job is more than just wrestling. Your job's more an entertainer. So it's more kind of, no comedy, but it's like an all-round thing. Like, if you can entertain people that aren't wrestling fans, then entertaining wrestling fans should be easy. Do you know what I mean? So you learn a totally different side of it. And, as you said as well, some of the talent that come on the camps, like some guys I would never get the chance to work with. Do you know what I mean? Guys like BT Gunn, Liam Thompson, Dean Allmark, Rampage Brown. Even just been amongst them, even if I'm not actually wrestling them, just been amongst them and listening to them and picking their brains and stuff, like, that's invaluable, man.
Yeah, I mean, one of the biggest proponents for camp shows is William Regal. You always hear him speaking about it. I mean, if you're going to look down on something, but not look down on Regal, who is talent relations, head of talent scouts for NXT and all that kind of stuff, then what are you doing? It must be just me getting the offers, I'm thinking.
Yeah, and they want that much, so I don't even know if I should be saying this, but he sent his son over to work the camps the year that I first done it. His son was learning to be a wrestler, and that was, he says, this is the best way to learn. And obviously flew him out to England and made them work the full camp line.
Exactly.
If it's good enough for him, it's good enough for me, do you know what I mean?
Exactly, yeah. Yeah, absolutely. If it's good enough for head talent scouts for the biggest company in the world to put their son on them, then absolutely.
And I think David Finlay done the same, and he started out, his dad put him on the camps, and look at him now, he's in ROH New Japan, one of the best wrestlers in the world, so...
So it's definitely something to aspire to be as well. So you work many places in Scotland. So Rock and Wrestle, SWA, of course, Home Promotion, and Pro Wrestling Scotland, Pro Wrestling Innovation, where you've kind of struck up a partnership with Danny Edwards and Matt Tyson. So. Yeah. How did that all come about? Was this just you got all guys came up at the same time, or was there anyone that was putting you together, or how'd that get?
So obviously when Pro Wrestling Innovation started, they were using a lot of guys that are like the same guys as other shows, and they were looking to do something a wee bit different, just to have something that's like an act that you wouldn't see anywhere else. So Matt Tyson was becoming a manager at the time, and they just decided that it would be a good fit. to put us together, and I really enjoyed it because it was something completely different from what I'd never really worked with a manager before, and it helped me learn more and kind of branch into different things as well. So I was totally up for it from the get-go. Had great fun with it, just trying different stuff, doing some funny promos and stuff. And then it was a wee bit later they decided to put Danny in the mix, and I feel like the three years bounce off each other well. We've got three completely different characters, but I think they kind of blend well. So it was something cool, something different. So a lot of fun, man.
It's definitely another feather in your cap to work with a manager, especially if you got a manager that's charismatic, which Matt is, because I've seen his promos for PWI. At least it gives you that little extra edge where you don't have to say anything. You just have to kind of let your face and actions do the talking, but you still have to use your face and actions, so you can't just sit there and just do nothing. So it's now a bit of a learning experience. Speaking of PWI, we do have a question from Krieger. Well, not so much a question. He just put, ask him to tell the story about when he jogged me out on karaoke.
So I can't remember when this was. Was it last year or the year before? I can't remember exactly, but we ended up in a night out one night. I think it was after a camp, so it would have been the summer. So myself, Krieger, and a couple other guys, I can't remember exactly, we ended up at a pub, and they're doing karaoke. So myself and Krieger, like a wee duet then again. So we'd been up and we'd sang one song. Can't even remember what it was for the life of me. So we got a few more drinks. Well, I'm going to do another duet. So I try to think, what can we sing? And I was like, got it. We'll sing Don't Let the Sun Come Down on Me, Elton John and George Michael. And he was like, perfect, brilliant. So went up, said to the DJ, he's like, right, boys, your turn. So I've started singing and he kept going to butt in, and I was like, no, you need to wait till your bit comes up. But unbeknown to me, the DJ hadn't put the duet version on, he'd only put Elton John's version on. So I just sang the full song and he just stood there for like 3.5 minutes, did nothing.
Oh, I could just imagine I was just in the corner just going, no. did you get another goal, or was that a night Krieger huffed off and was just like, nah, I'm not doing it anymore?
I went a half, he wasn't happy. So he cast it up at every opportunity.
So what would be your ideal karaoke song then? Would it be that, or have you got a one in the back pocket that you like to go for?
Myself and Krieger like a wee rendition of Islands in the Stream. That's probably our go-to.
I was gonna back my head thinking, oh, it'd be funny if we did that, but I'm not. I don't want to, and I don't think you want to either. go do a wee bit of a rendition Island in the Stream, just because.
Oh, that would just give him something else to moan about.
Oh no, I've been told that my singing is the worst thing in the world because I don't sing. I just like warble, like moan.
Yeah, mine isn't great either, but I think we're all guilty. You get a few too many beers and you're like, oh, I've got a great voice, man, let's go.
Oh yeah, there's many a time where I remember doing Blink-182 thinking I sounded just like them, and then when I play back in the morning going, I just screamed that
awful.
3 minutes. Oh. So we've got more questions in, not just about your karaoke, someone on Facebook, which I'm assuming are just your mates, because the first one is from Mark Bryson. Which just says, does Dean Ford still wear women's pants and makeup when he's home alone, or is he grown out of that now? So,
not always, only occasionally.
I saw your...
It's got quite lonely, so you need to do what you need to do, do you know what I mean?
I mean, it's lockdown just now, we need to fill the days, do whatever. But I saw your Halloween costume. Which totally dates this along with the Tash. But yeah, I saw your Tiger King. Jokes.
That's actually where the Tash came from. I never actually intended doing November, so I've always been a massive Halloween buff, but I don't know, it's just the time of year I was, even for November, right to the next Halloween, I'm constantly thinking, right, where can I dress up as? Always, and it's just, I wasn't letting lockdown come in the way yet, so. Since Tiger King came out in like February or March, I was like, that's happening. 100% that's happening.
My plan this year was going to be Fat Thor, but I wasn't going anywhere, so what was the point? Just because it was like, it's the beard. It's beard and bald head, so you're limited from that point onwards, and you can't go into a lycra suit if you're a bit chunky like I am, so that's out of the question. But as soon as I saw Thor in Endgame, I was like, Halloween, done. That's it. It's made for me.
I never got to see that now.
Maybe next year I'll bust out the cardigan. It's just a big Lebowski costume, isn't it, really? Except with a hammer. And I've always wanted a Mjolnir, but apparently I'm too grown up to get a Thor's hammer. So maybe one day. That's the excuse. I'll get a hammer just so I can dress up as him for Halloween.
Sounds good to me.
We've got Chris Robb with a couple questions. One we've kind of already covered, which is he keeping the tash after Movember, which we've established, maybe. We don't know.
See how we go.
Are you just hoping it goes right down like the Hulk Hogan Fu Manchu?
No, so that's what I had for Joe Exotic, and then it was awful, so I trimmed it back a wee bit, and then I've just gathered this. But I'm quite liking the wee Bronson curly bits. Keeps me amused. So
it makes you feel smarter as well when you just spend your time just twirling it.
Yeah.
So he's put. Chris has also put. Does Dean Ford shine his head, or is it normally shiny? Which I'm a little bit offended by.
Master Sheen, three times a week. I've not actually shined it, so you can obviously see it's not.
Honestly,
as good as it should be, but
thank goodness you can see the glare that I've got off the light above me. So at least it's just the one of us that's dazzling the screen here. But no, I'm a little bit offended by it as a balding man myself. It works.
You know yourself how difficult is upkeep? It's awful, man.
Well, mine's really irritating because I'm actually not bald. It's all hair, but it's super blonde. No one believes me until I have to like coerce them, go touch my head, which is never a good conversation for anyone, but it's like, well, no, it's hair, trust me. But it goes from at the moment I really need a haircut because it's like a horseshoe, dark, and then blonde at the top. So upkeep's terrible. I do it myself, but there's always a big
I'm the same, but I get lazy, and then the longer it gets, it's just even more of a hassle.
Do you feel like it's like a mullet at the back? You're just like going, no, this isn't right.
Yeah. Ugh. During lockdown, when the first lockdown hit, I was like, I'm just going to leave it and just see what happens. And I left it for ages, left my beard for ages, and I was like, nah, like, homeless.
Yeah, I was the same. Well. Yeah, I pretty much got
I was
March.
Hoping it would actually grow back, but it was at bits, but then it was like, transparent at bits, and I was like, nah, get it off.
So, no, I pretty much got marched upstairs with bear clippers going, nah, this is going now. I tried the beard for a bit, and I trimmed it back once, and it hasn't grown back the same way, and it's really annoyed me, because it was quite long and proper at the start of lockdown, and then I thought, I'll get a wee trim, and it's just, this is where it stayed. It's not going any further, which is super annoying. The last question that Chris has got here is a great one. Why are Dugs so awesome?
I don't know, they just are.
I would have my dog as a special guest, but she is deciding she's sleeping downstairs, so fair enough to her. I would choose sleep if I could. But dogs are just the best. So we'll go back to your matches, because it's a wrestling podcast, apparently.
Yep.
Was it your first title win? Was it the tag titles at Shield? Was that your first title?
Yep.
So what was it like winning a title in pro wrestling? Obviously, we can't discuss who you were tagged with, but what was it like getting a title?
Yeah, it was really cool, man. So I think I had only worked shoot once or twice. My debut was a singles match, and then my second match was the tag titles, but I was like, obviously just getting into it lose. So that was fine. And then the promoter had messaged me and said they were quite enjoyed that match. I think at this point, somebody else had won the tag titles. And it was one of the ones that we weren't there. I think it was Tribad. It's Paddy Flanagan and Hayden Tempest. They had just won the tag titles. And Paddy had posted something on Twitter, and I just commented on it with two eyes. Just like, I'm bored, I'm just going to wind him up. So we ended up going out of back and forth on Twitter, and the promoter loved it. And he's like, we've got to give you a tag title match. And I was like, all right, cool. Got there, and he's like, I'm winning. I was like, that's brilliant, man. I didn't expect that in the slightest. So then we ended up getting into a feud with them for, I think it was 5 or 6 months, which ended in a 4-team gauntlet. And we were the first team in. That was hard, man. But it was a cool wee run. Because obviously most companies up here don't really run storylines because they get different crowds all the time. But the good thing about Shield is that they've got a really loyal fan base. So every month you go, it's the exact same people. So they can run storylines because the same crowd are coming back every month. So that was the first time I kind of got to do stuff like that. So that was really fun, man.
Yeah, I mean, it's also a lot of trust put into you as well, because you're going to a new environment, totally new. It's across the border as well. So it was a little bit daunting. I mean, when you're working up here, you probably see quite a few of the same faces wherever you go. But going into a totally new, I mean, you would have had people, because they usually have quite a few from up here, go down to Shield. But how was it going into a totally different locker room?
I knew a few of the boys. I'd worked at UCW before. So I'd worked with Assassin and Nikki Starr previously, and I knew a few of the other boys just who've been on the show. So it was quite daunting to start with, but the full locker room, like, they couldn't, they're just great people, man. Like, it's like a family atmosphere down there. Everybody gets on great. So it was brilliant, man. But it was quite weird as well, because when we first went down, always it went down, we're all heels, and we were like the biggest heels on the show. They absolutely hated us, man. And I don't know if it was, I think because Tribad at the time were such big heels, they decided to turn us babyface, and I thought, this is not going to work, man. Like, they absolutely hate us. And it was as if, because they hated them so much and we beat them, we just became the biggest baby faces in the company. And it was, like, ridiculous, man. Like, from one extreme to the other. But it just shows you how committed the fan base is. Like, if they accept you, do you know what I mean? So that was pretty cool, man. Because I hadn't done a lot of tag team wrestling at that point. I'd done the odd one, like, showcase matches or the odd show, where you just get through in, like, you and another guy. But that was the first time I had, like, established a team sort of thing. So it was a learning experience for me to do more tag team stuff, because I enjoy tag team wrestling, I always have, but I just never really had the chance to do it as much. So that was cool, man. And obviously being babyface when I had, obviously most of my career I've been a heel. So again, you're learning in that regard as well, so that was good fun, man.
So the other question I've got here, just because we're speaking about you going all over the place, so yeah, a brawl, wasn't it? Yeah, UCW. Also went as far north as Caithness Pro. So we've got Dave Whitelaw asking, where's the greatest place you've ever wrestled, and why do you pick Thurso?
Thurso is actually great fun, man. I loved up there. I don't know if it's because they're so far out of the way. Like, most of the wrestling, you know yourself, even like in Elgin and stuff, there's not an awful lot. It's mostly throughout the central belt. So in Thurso, there's very, very little. And I think there's only three shows a year up there. So, like, sometimes when you're wrestling, like, Glasgow and surrounding areas, people just, it's there that often that they just expect it. Do you know what I mean? But in Thurso, it's a big thing. Like, some of these kids have never seen wrestling before. I've been to a show sort of thing. So they're like, it's their favourite weekend of the year. So it's just a great atmosphere, man. I had so much fun up there. And I was just my usual self, just been a horrible man. And the heel heat I got was great, man. Like, my first time up there, I was nearly fighting with a drunk guy.
I'm sure I've seen...
Drunk guy tried to get in the ring, which is great. And then I think the second time, there was a wee child who was trying to give me up, and I threw a chair at him. So that's one way to establish that you're a bad guy, innit?
When CPW, when they had their shows on YouTube, I ended up watching a couple of them, and yeah, their fans are just, they're rabid. They're ready for wrestling. But when you say that, they're only, I mean, four times a year they had shows, on outward 3 months, and especially up that far. I mean, for me, Elgin, so I'll get one show a year in Elgin. There'll be one in Inverness, and then WrestleZone will run most of the time. The other side in Aberdeen, but Aberdeen's an arse to get to be honest. It's a day. It's an excursion for the day. So it's not like I could just go around and pop to the wrestling and then get on the rest of my day. But yeah, we're quite, when there's wrestling on, the fans are usually very rabid, because like you say, Central Belt, there you can pick and choose your shows most weekends when they were on. And they're only within an hour maybe of each other. And
some shows, like there's some weekends there's three shows across maybe 30 mile radius, do you know what I mean? It's mental. It's not hard to find wrestling, where obviously the further north you go, it's harder and harder. So it was a lot of fun, man. And I think I only wrestled for Caithness twice, but I had the two matches I had were both really fun as well. Like, I think I wrestled Angel Hayes the first time. It was my first ever intergender match. I didn't really know how they would take it. But, like, as you know, she's one of the best talents in the country, man. Like, obviously, I trained well and stuff, but to get in there where you don't realise how good she is. And then the second time I was up, it was myself and Robert Wishart, an R guy that's been about for a long time, obviously, recreated himself. And we had absolutely great fun, man.
Oh, that's a match I'm going to have to see, because I've seen Robbie's matches around where he was doing, where he was in Source and that at the moment, where he's reinvention, and yeah, I'm going to assume there's a lot of kicks being thrown about quite.
It was just a fair war, battered seven shades of dark stuff at each other. But that's a match we've spoke about it a few times. Hopefully we get to do it again somewhere else, because that was great fun, man.
I respect your avoiding of keeping up with the no swearing rule, because that was
I seen the sweat coming down your forehead.
I'm gonna have to edit this. So social media. You said you pretty much got a tag title shot in Shield just through our social media interaction.
Pretty much.
Other than the infamous photo, the other thing that went around social media quite a lot was your GIF. Kicking Yuno Raw in the face. So have you found during this lockdown period that because there's no wrestling on, you've had to kind of up your social media game? And because I noticed I'm one of many podcasts that have picked you up, including at this point it would have been a couple months on, but Jason Hyde's Attempt to Socialize, which I listened to yesterday as of recording. Is it just a case of just wanting to just find your ways to keep your name relevant, or is there any reason?
Not really, man. Like, when all the lockdown hit and that, I was quite disillusioned. Like, I think everybody went through different ways of dealing with it. and I kind of took it quite tough because I've always been so active and stuff, and I was finding it quite hard that I wasn't able to train and do all the things that I like doing. So I just kind of didn't really bother for the first few months. The social media, I just didn't see the point at all. And then I don't know if it was just through boredom and stuff, I started getting back on and I started sharing old matches and stuff just to give me a wee interest, give me something to do, and a bit of banter online, and that led to obviously doing some podcasts and stuff, so it was good, man.
Yeah, I mean, you're quite open with your mental health struggles, especially during this lockdown. I mean, not only that, lockdown started in March, and of course, you know what happened in June, and that was a whole other thing. So it's really good to see that you kind of picked yourself up. I know it's still going to be coming ebbs and waves, and that, especially when at this stage, as of recording, there's lockdowns and tiers, and when it comes to this coming out in February, it could all be over, it could all still be going, it could be worse, we have no idea. So we're hoping not worse, obviously. But it's good to see you've put yourself out there. So I just saw you messaged me after I offered a spot, which would have been coming out in November, but obviously things escalated between now and between when we chatted and when this is happening. And you picked up by guys like Kurt Johansson and obviously Jason Hyde and everywhere else. So have you found the doing podcasts and speaking about wrestling has kind of helped reignite a little bit of interest back into it, or at least being able to get some frustration out
I'm not right, obviously getting into details and stuff, but as you say, with the lockdown and all the other stuff that was happening, man, it was for a long time I questioned myself, like I didn't even know if this is what I was right to do anymore. Like I think when things happen, man, you don't think straight and your mind's out of place. So for a long time at one point I deleted social media. Like I had my profiles and stuff, but I just wiped everything off my phone, like I needed a break for everything. And I got over that, and I think you're right. I started to enjoy wrestling again. I started to enjoy some parts of social media. Obviously, it's still, Twitter can be a great thing, but it can be a horrible thing at the same time. So I like parts of it, and I ignore all the bad parts of it. I've found myself just able to block all that out. So doing stuff like this is good fun, man. This is like the party that I really enjoy. And like having a banter and like gifts and matches and like carry-ons online and stupid things like that. That's the way it should be used. That's what I enjoy, do you know what I mean? So
I think once you realise how easy it is to set up a Twitter account and how simple it is just to hide behind a profile picture, I think once you realise that, you can kind of like ignore the negative ones, because I know when I started doing this podcast, of course, it's difficult to get some of the bigger names, because if I'm getting the bigger names, I have to discuss about things I don't want to discuss about because of what's happened. So I was getting lots of trolls going, oh, why are you only speaking to trainees, why are you only speaking to so and so, and these are all accounts that were created that month. So at first I was like, oh, okay, I'll go find other people to speak to, but which I did. But I don't think those conversations were as good because I was seeking someone to speak to me. Whereas if people seek to speak to me, they've got a story to share, and it makes it better. I find anyway, because like I said, I offered you a spot, but you didn't have to say yes. So if you said yes, there's ones I kind of went, do you want to do it? Do you want to do it? Do you want to do it? Kind of thing. I've forced them into this environment. But of course, you're having a bit of banter saying everyone's doing podcasts but you, but of course you have got a story to share, because we'll be speaking for close to an hour, so obviously there's stuff to be said. I've rambled there, that doesn't make sense, but
that's all right, man.
So we'll go back to questions, because I think I've just got the one. It's it's one of the odder ones. It's just from Jetstream Jack. He's put, what do you think about Shrek? I don't know if it means the person or the film, but I'll let you decide.
Or the musical. Going with the film, absolute timeless classic, man. And the second one's even better, so... Aye. Absolute brilliant.
I think we discussed that the third one's pretty creepy with the wee
older babies. The third one's a bit strange. I wasn't a fan, but the first two are just genius. Mike Myers and Eddie Murphy as a double actor, just absolutely hilarious.
And the only other question I've got before we do a little bit of a 10 count word association is, what's your favourite dinosaur? It's from Kevin Williams. That's his usual question, which is... obviously, it's fitting, seeing as he busted you open. So, yeah. It's good to go questioning.
Velociraptor.
Oh, yeah. So, the ones that... that's the image I'm going with. Just because they're quite quick, nimble, or just because they look cool?
They just look cool, man.
Fair enough. I've had many options. I've had Rex already. That's one's popped up quite a bit. But, yeah, I think had a couple of Velociraptors, I'm sure. You've got merch available. Nice white t-shirts with Prizefighter Demon Forward on them. Where did you design the logo yourself? Or
it was CRK Graphics. Designed a lot of the merch for the Scottish Wrestling Scene. Really good guy, man. You'll find him on Twitter. I think I'm saying it right. If not,
him. I'm sure I've seen him somewhere. I might have retweeted stuff with him before.
Aye, he was great, man. Handled a lot of stuff for me, made it really easy. And if MDs want a t-shirt, hit me up, man.
We'll get your social media plugs right before we wrap up, and we'll get people going your way. Like I say, this is coming out a little bit earlier next year, so 2021. So if you get a big influx of orders then I'm hoping it'll be down to us. So we've got 10 count. So it's really just 10 names, word association. I've picked kind of people that you've wrestled, spoke about in other places. We might end up spinning off because I know that you've got a big love for who will be in our number 10 spot. And I'm well in for speaking about him. So we'll just start off with number one. So word association, first thing comes to your head, Danny Edwards.
Weasel.
Krieger.
Boyfriend.
Number three, Rob Van Dam.
Legend.
Four, Undisputed Era.
Cool.
Five, Steve Blackman.
Oh man, what a guy. As I can say, what a guy.
Six, Crow Cop.
Genius.
Seven, Alistair Black.
Inspiration. I'm not into all the devil stuff and that. I mean, I've read it at the end, but aye.
He's the kicks. Yeah, he's the kicks over the devil stuff. Eight, TJ Rage.
Mentor.
Nine, Jason Hyde.
Friend.
That's a nice one. Ten, Shane McMahon.
The absolute greatest of all time. I don't care what MD says.
You know what? If you go by per match overall, there's rarely been a bad match from Shane McMahon.
See, rarely. I get so much. You've probably heard this on the Jason Hyde's podcast. I get so much stick for this, man. Like, people think I'm at it, and I'm genuinely not. Like, if you go with the bare bones, right? Everybody's like, "Oh, he's not a proper wrestler." Well, what is? What do you? Why do you watch wrestling? What do you want? You know what I mean? You want to be entertained. You want moments that you'll remember all your life, and you want to see stuff you've never seen before. Shane gives you every single one. How many guys have you seen jump off a Titantron before he done it? The guy jumped out of a helicopter and survived. You know what I mean?
It's just, yeah, like I say, if you go by a per match basis, well, he's maybe had, what, 20 matches ever since 2000? And try and think of a bad one.
Can?
Maybe King of the Ring, 2000, not 2001, because that was one of the best matches of all time.
We all got to fight there, boy.
What, 2000 was the six-man tag?
Aye, that was awful, but...
Yeah, but 2001 was the best match
my opinion, the greatest match of all time.
Absolutely. It's one of my... top five ever. I'd have that. Aye. And he would have another match kicking, like, chapping at the door as well versus Steve Blackman.
Well, that... And even his match with Big Show at Backlash, I can't remember what year, when they done the spot off the... Was it a last man standing match? They done the spot for the Titantron, and then Test hung him on the camera. That was good, man. See, just his creativity, amazing, man.
Exactly. I mean,
a guy that isn't necessarily supposed to be a wrestler. Well, find another guy that's not a wrestler and tell him to do a shooting star press at 55-year-old. You know what I mean?
Exactly. I mean, he's literally the greatest wrestler of all time. He won a trophy in Saudi Arabia and everything. So.
See, that's my argument, but I just think he's amazing, man. Even since I was a kid, I was like, there was always something likeable about him, but like, he got under your skin as well. He was good at what he was there to do, you know what I mean? The music and the dancing and the... I love Shane, man.
But no, go back to your point, which is, I think, is the big overarching thing of wrestling now, it's moments. That's the big buzzword WWE have got at the moment. Pardon the pun, but that is what wrestling is. You go to a show and you come out at the end. Are you going to remember the 10 minutes of wrist locks and transitions? Or are you going to remember the one guy doing the shooting star press? It could be the shooting star press. That's the bit you remember. But you're going to remember all these little things. Or I mean, I will because I'm a nerd about this stuff. But is a kid going to remember this? Or are they going to remember the big baldy guy, big baldy baddie, doing a spin kick and knocking someone out? That's the bit they're going to remember.
This is what promoters want for their talent these days, especially as you say, the bigger companies. They want stuff that they can put in a promo package or a highlight reel to show what their product is. You're not going to put 10 minutes of chain wrestling. I've nothing against that style of wrestling. I love to watch it. I don't do it very much because I'm not very good at it. But that's not something that you're going to put to promote your show. You're going to put people getting kicked, people doing dives, people doing stupid, I don't know, and through tables and stuff. That's the moments that people remember that want to come back. And Shane has won them in probably every single one of his matches he's ever had. So the coast to coast against Vince, and then you'd elbow drop to the outside, the shooting star, the dive off the Titantron.
But no, that's it. I mean, wrestling in a show in itself is a variety show. You can have the chain wrestling, like I say, I don't mind it. It would be top of my list of things. I find it difficult when I'm doing reviews and I see it's just loads of chain wrestling. I'm just like back and forth, transitions.
I think it's one of the things, it's good when done well. Like, at the top level, when you've got guys like Zack Sabre and even in our country, guys like Andy Wilde and Liam and guys that are good at it, they make it look seamless. Dean Allmark, Jonathan Gresham, guys like that. But some people, when it's just under the look, wrestle up, like, there's only so much you can do and before it gets a bit stale, unless it is high-level stuff.
Absolutely, yeah. I never thought of that.
You need a mesh everything, man, because again, you don't want loads of spots either, like a full match full of spots. It's getting the balance and telling stories as well. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, I never saw that. I last match I watched Randy Wilde, he did all that, but he paused and taunted the crowd, got them involved, and that's, you're exactly right. When it's done well, it's great, but if it's done just like, this is the movements we're doing, let's get them all done and then move on to the next thing. It just,
So anything, man, that, see if it looks like a contest, it's like I don't know if you can remember that match last year. There was two young indie boys in America. I don't know if it was GCW or something. They tried to recreate the kind of Ricochet Osprey style spot. But they get so much stick because it wasn't as smooth. But it's a similar thing. Like that, anything done well looks good. But if you try and replicate it and it's not at the same level, it's not going to look great. Do you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Right, I'm just going to double check to make sure I've got no other questions popping in. But no, I asked you about Shrek, which... I like Shrek, so that's fine. Any dreams? Dreams? I don't want to know about vivid dreams, but any dream matches, dream promotions that you want to get to when the shows return?
Promotion-wise, obviously everybody's got great aspirations to go to the top, but I'm just enjoying just branching out, man. There's a few in Scotland that I've still not wrestled. I'd like to get on there, places like Respect, Reckless Intent, Discovery. It's probably more I can't think of. There's obviously a lot in England. I've just kind of started it in England. Branch out, there's so many good companies down there. Ireland, Europe. Just keep branching out, keep doing my thing, keep learning, man. Opponents, there's so many, man. Dream matches. Probably by name, the guy I probably like to wrestle most, probably Mark Haskins. I think he's just a total hybrid of every different style. Like, he can go hold for hold, he can strike, he can fly, he can do everything, man. Like, so good to watch. Another one's probably Speedball Mike Bailey, just to think they'd just kick the colour at each other. So that'd be fun.
When you mentioned Discovery, that was the one I had in my head, because it's like, for Scotland, I think it's one of the best hybrid companies. It has your, like we were saying, it has the chain wrestling, but they bring in guys that can do it at a high level. Yeah. And then they've got the fun stuff. They bring in guys like Grado, and then they've got Joe Henry, who can do just about anything as well. So it's that's definitely one of the places where I could see Dean Ford.
Your product's really good, man, because I've been to the shows a few times, and as you say, they kind of tick all the boxes, you know what I mean? You've got your comedy stuff with like Grado and Shug D and Gene Money. You've got some high-level women's wrestling. Then you've got some tag stuff. Then you've got hold-for-hold stuff. You've got American Indie style stuff. They give you everything, you know what I mean? And that's a place I've wanted to work for a long time. Obviously, ICW as well. I debuted there last year. But that's a place I'd love to get back into, man. There's even just their roster just now. There's so many guys that I have wrestled before and guys that I haven't, that I reckon I'd have great matches with. So hopefully once everything gets back to normal, we can push forward and try and make some of that happen, man.
Excellent. Right, so I won't keep you any longer. I think we've just about over the hour mark, and it's just past 9 to go behind the curtain here. And it's winter, so it's dark, it's rubbish out there. So let's just wrap up and go to sleep or get a drink or whatever. But yeah, where can people find you on social media? Where can they go and buy your merch?
So on Instagram and Twitter, I am Dean Ford _BRZFTR, because I was too lazy to write Prizefighter. My Facebook, I think it's Dean Ford PW. If you message me in any of the platforms, just private message me. If you want to buy a t-shirt, just let me know. I'll get that sorted. That would be brilliant. And also, if possible, can I plug my November page?
Well, I'm sure it'll still be up come February.
Yeah. February it might not be. I'll plug it anyway, and if it's up, and MD would like to donate. I don't know the code for it, but if Billy would be nice enough to drop it somewhere, that'd be much appreciated.
Well, I'll do. I'll find the link after we've wrapped up, and I'll put it out now. as of recording, just to time it, just so people can get in, because it's just about the end of November, so I'll do that. Perfect, as man. Well.
That's much appreciated, thank you. So any donations on that would be fantastic.
I just hope people don't go list this in February and then go back to my page around about then 18th of November and I haven't done it and I'll go and look like a right idiot. But I'll definitely do that. But yeah, thank you very much for joining me.
Thanks for having me. That was good fun, man.
I've super enjoyed it and hopefully...
Good to be positive about wrestling again for a change.
That's what this podcast's for. We don't want to go on all the bad stuff because we don't want to end up being depressed ourselves. We just want to have a bit of fun, chill, relax. Wrestling's supposed to be fun.
Exactly.
So we'll try to keep it that way.
Wrestling's supposed to be fun.
I think that's the best way
to... I had a great time talking about Shrek, Splatheads and everything in between.
It was literally the first thing I had on my notes here. W3L, head split. Because that was the first thing I wanted to ask about. But yeah, thank you very much for joining me.
No problem, thank you.